And what I see is that every generation has to have its own definition. My father, for him, it was peace. After the Second World War, for him, it was the mission of peace. And the most thing he worried about was that his generation will die and no one will remember how dreadful peace is. For my brother, it was economic cooperation, that suddenly this was possible. For me, it's freedom to travel in Europe, to work where I like. I'm a German working in the Netherlands, running in Austria a conference. So that's totally natural. Our students live in Belgium, study in the Netherlands, go shopping in Germany. No questions asked, even the warranty for your products stays the same. Perhaps for the next generation, it's about Europe as a partner in globalization, that is our entity. But perhaps you have a totally different definition. And when you're dealing with child health and you saw, well, shall we have access to 500,000 in a birth cohort? How can we make this happen? What are the differences in mentality, the social background, the ethnic background, all those, you know, how can we make this happen? So it will be not an easy way for Europe to go on. But at least 20 years ago, they decided, let's have a health mandate. And since then, health is in business. Okay, in research, health programs, health projects were funded, but since 20 years, we are really dealing with this. So it's not long ago. And as it's typically, they started in 91, made the signature in 92, so it came in power in 93, so we have three reasons to celebrate this, however you Maastricht people love to celebrate. So what was in this treaty? Don't try to read this. The summary is a high level of human health protection shall be ensured in the definition implementation of all European Union policies. Translation of this health is in all policies. And the last sentence is, but the member states are still responsible for their health care system. So that are those two poles we're working on. And let's say at the beginning, what is easy to work on, that summarizes, we can develop indicators, we can compare the different countries, we can find best practice exchange, and if we have this, we can set up some guidelines. 70% of the posters outside do exactly this. So you're totally in line with the treaty, and you do what we're doing. There was this nice slide, is the grass on the other side of the border greener than at home? Of course it is in the first moment. And then you realize, there might be some drawbacks too. But that is what public health in Europe is about, to see how the situation is in the different countries. Let's compare. And the Chinese love to come to Europe. Where can you study 27 or 28 healthcare systems in 2 weeks? Yeah. But after those 2 weeks, they say, well, I'm not sure if we will adopt any of this, because you know they all collapse when there is the first crisis. So we have to see that in Asia, for example, they have very interesting healthcare reforms, much more innovative than we have. But for us, at the moment here, to learn from each other is a huge experience. And then we can set up guidelines. You can argue, my country will not be interested in having European guidelines. You know, what those guys in Brussels decide, even if we help them to do, who cares? Does anyone of you know European guidelines? For example, in the breast cancer screening, they were one of the first European guidelines, how to organize breast cancer screening. And a lot of patient groups and pressure groups and NGOs use this, arguing with their government, saying, we want this, there's a European guideline. If you think about implementing it, please stick to those guidelines. And this is not well documented, but the effect of this is really important, and it's a high effect. So if you can agree on some European guidelines with your work and can make it happen somewhere there endorsed, Joanne can tell you how to do this, then you can make a difference. And because it's from the member states for the member states. Europe is no kingdom. There is no queen or king in Europe. It would be much more entertaining. Perhaps we have an unshorn queen. But for me, Europe is itself a group of the member states. And if you really look at it, it's innovative. So let's help ourselves create some guidance that the other colleagues then can use. You know those slides. WHO Health for All database, just to remember you how diverse Europe is. Life expectancy from 1970 to 2011 or 2010 on this, you see that the old member states have an unbroken record of life expectancy gain. But you see too that some countries in Europe had a totally different experience. If we take out the noise, this is what is left. The blue one is Spain, the green one is Poland, and the red one is Latvia. Okay, you say, what in the hell does this have to do with child health? No, it's general information to get you a flavor in what situation those countries work. And perhaps someone is here from Spain, perhaps someone from Poland is here, or perhaps someone from Latvia. And what you see is that, for example, Spain, as classified, let's say, an old member, European member state, life expectancy as a hardcore parameter moved up. But when you look, for example, to Poland and Latvia until the 1990s, there was a stable situation, no real gain. And then suddenly, with the fall of the Iron Curtain, the Polish took off and the Latvian went down. Is someone here from the Baltic countries? Yeah? Have you experienced those times? You look so young, so I don't know. Do you know that you had this drop in life expectancy at this time?
I'm from Poland.
You're from Poland. You're from Poland. You're the lucky one. You're the other one. Okay. Someone from the Baltic countries. Some research said that when they got independent, the Russians cut off the power supply, the gas supply, so heating and all those things were difficult, and infant mortality rose. And life expectancy is very dependent on infant mortality. And this drop is because of those huge changes this Baltic countries had. And then they recovered, and now they're on the road to recovery. And they're doing quite well. And you remember those slides about infant mortality you saw in the morning, that the Baltic countries are those who had the highest reduction because they had high levels in the beginning. And it's a success story too, even if you can argue now, well, the differences in life expectancy in 1970 were 3 years and now they're nearly 10 years. So inequalities increase. Yes, it's higher, but you have to know the history to make the right conclusions of it. Do you have any idea how long it will take to close this gap that we see now, let's say, to bring it again back to 3 years? Any idea how long this will take? How much money we have to transfer, how much manpower, and what we have to do? I don't know either. But there has been a natural experiment, and that was East and West Germany. Normally, these are several slides. I condense it in one because time is short. You see from 1956 to 2007, life expectancy in Germany, the dotted line are the females. We know that they have a higher life expectancy. W means western part of Germany, E means eastern part, and the males have the solid line there. If you look at it closely, until 1976, remember what you have done in 1976. Until 76, there was no difference between East and West Germany. And the race was open. It was an ideological battle. Cold War was still going on, and not so intensive, but still there was a divide and nothing. But then from 76 on, there was a widening in the gap. And in the end, in 1989, 1990, it were 4 years in women's health, and something similar, I think, 4.5 in men's health, difference between East and West. And the interesting thing is, at once, 1 year later, things begin to change. And it took 20 years to close the gap in life expectancy for the females. And this was combined with a massive transfer from money from the west to the east, infrastructure. On the other hand, healthy people left East Germany, so you can say the old and the sick stayed there. It's exaggerated, but so even that would be a bias that it's not closing the gap so early. But if you put all you can into this, it will last at least 20 years to get an equal situation. And now you can calculate, are there any West Bulgarians? Are there any West Romanians? There will not be this money. There will be some structural funds money from them. But we can have now a feeling that it will take at least another two decades to get those country money. So this is a marathon we are working on. And just imagine those little slides, the drop of like the Baltic countries, the link to the life, to the infant mortality, the progress they made. So the puzzle comes together quite nicely. And of course we see that in the countries we have differences of life and inequalities. You know the slide, the tubes, I think the Jubilee light in London, and the London Health Observatory calculated that by each tube stop you lose 1 year of your life expectancy when you go east, when you start in Westminster. Females start with 85 years, and when they arrive in Canning Town, they're about 70 years. I don't know if it helps if you move. If you move with 50, or if it's still. But I think it's the nicest one, piece of relation I ever seen about how inequality, and even the name Westminster has some associations where we can make the links. Okay, Maastricht Treaty, health was a good idea. Now it's 20 years ago. So we said, let's do an analysis. What went well, what went wrong, what were missed opportunities? And that's the most interesting for you because yeah, it's not so long, 20 years. We can learn from experience. It's not that I'm talking about 1700, 1500, or 1800. Yeah? So there were some initiators. On the one hand, we have the treaty, the Bible of what Europe is allowed to do. Then we had the European Court of Justice. Then we had the financial crisis. And in the end, there's a symbol for the internal market that has an influence on health. You remember this discussion about health personnel moving around. But there are conditions that shaped the EU. One is that the WHO is more a philosophical club, but the European Commission are hardcore lawmakers, regulators. So that's something they can do. Then it's about cooperation between the member states. What you can't achieve alone, we try to achieve together. And it's about capacity building. One of the foremost rights of the Commission is to invest in capacity buildings in the member states. So that is, let's say, the landscape that we plotted. And we interviewed 25 decision makers who were part of it, who really shaped this, and who now look back and said, well, I think it's like this or that. And what we saw is that this triangle of policy making that you all know, between content, and process, that there are some unknown mediating factors. Why sometimes things really go well, sometimes you fail, you try hard. Why suddenly a window of opportunity, as you heard before from Red, is there? Or why are the MEPs exactly doing now what they are doing? Let's look at this. What are those mediating factors? One is governance. In a way, there seems to be a missing EU governance model for EU health policy. There seems to be some external factors driving it, but there is no own governing ideology for this. Ideology, I mean, always in a positive way. Next, we found leadership. The first 10 years seemed to be very much about personalities who were in charge at the European level and were a face to public health, or the face of public health. In the second decade, some people told me, well, we are missing this. What is about this leadership issue? And there are only a few people who really stand up, for example, as the MEP, because health is an incomplete mandate, still the members in Russia. And there are few MEPs who stand up
I'm from Latvia, let's take this example, and my citizens, if their child has a rare disease, and it has a European passport, it's a European citizen. That is what we invented in the Maastricht Treaty too, the European citizenship. So when a European citizen, the child has a rare disease, then it must be possible that this person gets a decent treatment somewhere in Europe. Not a luxury treatment, but a decent treatment. And the European Commission should make this possible. So that the country where it's treated, they are not ripped off, and the citizen who seeks this help does not have to pay double the money as it normally is. So how to make a fair deal for this? And this kind of leadership seems to be missing at the moment. And we see that the broad set of actors involved in EU policy making can be a benefit and something that hampers. Because if too many people speak, you don't understand anything. Then you have noise. So we have to organize that. And there that one really has to say, Didier Sanku worked a lot on this, how to integrate the different NGOs, patient representations, to compensate a little bit for this democratic deficit that we have. And of course, it's about collaboration. And it's really proven that Didier Sanku seems to be one of those central nets, the spider in the net. And it mediates the EU role as reference point. We see this in different issues. And I did not even have to introduce Didier Sanku for you. It's known for you. Because normally people look at me a little bit, say, you know it because you heard of it, and you perhaps already worked together. But what we found in a lot of interviews was that there is a tension. Spannungsfeld is a German expression. In Austrian and German, in Switzerland, there is some associations. We could not translate it. We even asked some translating services, and they said, please ask me another question. We have something like conflicting poles. The health interest versus economic interest. Economic cooperation was a driving force of Europe. If this is conflicting with health issues, what is more important? How much health we can sacrifice for economic cooperation? Should we do this, or does it conflict with our business one? And then the other one is more or less European integration. Perhaps you heard the one is a horizontal and the other one is a vertical integration. More member states or fewer member states, and a deeper integration. What shall we do? For example, you will have an opinion on Turkey. Should it join, or should we say, no, stop, we wait a little bit, but we deepen our integration in the existing European country? But then Turkey might turn its face away and say, OK, I'll wear it now so long. I do my own thing. So that are decisions under risk, as we know in public health, where we always have to do this. So must be a very familiar situation. So we made a hit list. And when you download the slides, let's say, what is rank number one seemed to be the most important from looking back for 20 years from those decision makers who were involved. First, secondary legislation and court decisions. The European Court of Justice played an important role. Perhaps you know Mr. Decker. He's a lawyer from Luxembourg who went shopping abroad, and his wife saw nice glasses for him and said, well, what's about that fits you? He bought it, wanted to get it back from his insurance, and the insurance said, you brought it abroad, bad luck, we will not reimburse you. And he said, oh, I'm a lawyer, I love to sue people. At once, he sued his. And I hope that the recording is now not recording this. Even the health minister of Luxembourg called the insurance, please reimburse him his bloody glasses. You don't know what you're doing if you don't not do this. And they said, no, we have our rules, we don't do it. Yeah, and then the disaster happened. No politicians, the MEP, if she would be here, would say, no politician would ever have reached this like this single person. Getting to the European Court of Justice, and the court always decides in favor of the citizen, and he got it right. And then the lavine started. Now we have it. Not only, let's say, medical devices, primary care, we have hospital care, rehabilitation. Everything is possible now. This is a driving force. So, if something really gets on your nerves,
yeah, also the European Court of Justice, sue someone.
The patient right directive to cross-border care, very much linked to this, came on phase two. Because that gives us now a lot of possibilities how to deal with this, how to make it happen that we can not only exchange, but have treatment cooperations. When you are a dermatologist and you love to sail in Spain, but your patients are from Belgium, where it's always raining, yeah, go to Spain. And you specialize on second opinions, and you have your microscope and your fast internet line. And before they operate in Belgium, someone on a skin tumor, they ask you for the second opinion. And two hours a day, you sit in your private room and look through your microscope. You say yes and no. You don't have to be there anymore. We can work from everywhere we like. And to develop new ideas how this can happen. Suddenly we have an internal market. If you, yeah, you're working on this electronic patient record. How many Irish people are there? 6 million? Oh, 4 million. Europe has 500 million. If he has a success, he can roll this out to 500 million. So software development then suddenly gets a different dimension. And the law regarding directive on tobacco advertising, that is a success story too. And that was said by everyone, well, there we can learn a lot. What is about soft laws, strategies and programs? We had the first and second public health program, I think, where you all got some money from, directly or indirectly. Then Together for Health, the strategy was praised. That as an important, that's right. Have a look. I don't know if you ever knew that there is a strategy or has been until 2030, but will be prolonged. But it's worth reading. Very interesting issues in there. Because there, let's say the priorities are defined. And then the framework for action in public health or the community on health systems, the council conclusion on health systems, and Europe 2020. To those issues, I come a little bit. What about agencies? You know the medicine agency that was started since then. We only have one stop shop, as it is called now. If you want to have a drug on the market, you go there and they can work. A real success story. ECDC, not ACDC, that was the problem. ECDC as the one where the European citizens really like this idea. If you look at those interviews with Europeans, what do you expect from the European Union? Yeah, protection for those things that don't respect borders. And of course, that are the infectious diseases. And the food agency was rated quite high. Political and cooperative structures. Funny, the European presidencies were rated quite high. So if you want to reach something, try to influence them. Now they have this trio presidency, the three work together, but get it on the topics of the presidency. Make use of it. All experts said if you are part of it, something will happen. And I don't know if this mirrors your personal experience, but it seems to be that it's not just that Europe is not just a travel agency, but it makes sense to me. Then the cooperation between European Commission, WHO, and OECD was rated quite high. So WHO, and I think the European Commission is the fifth biggest donor now to WHO. They cooperate in health information systems now, very formally and so on. So if you have good links to WHO, you can influence from the side. And you should not only go for one direction, Europe is the lawmaker, so I go. No, perhaps sometimes these philosophical people can have some ideas. Do you remember the health report WHO 2000? Long ago. They made a ranking of health systems. It was a scandal because they had three criteria and everything. Oh, the data are wrong, the criteria are wrong. Some years later, we had the same criteria in the open method of coordination. A little bit differently phased, but it needed this several years to discuss this and to develop it further. And so some things enter the European circle a little bit later. And then you have all those meetings, the EU Health Policy Forum. I don't know exactly how many members that are 55 to 60. You have networks for infectious diseases. You have this network for HTA. That is about Europe, bringing people together and deciding on a common future. Others working on health determinants. We heard social inequalities so often, and social determinants of health. Here the comments were, if I show a graph with a difference, my students tell me, oh, there's an inequality. I say, no, it's a difference. To be an inequality, it has to fulfill some other criteria. But it's so much now streamlined, I think that is a very good best practice exchange we discussed. And scientific reports in the end, don't get frustrated, at least you're in the hit list number 3. So having something for the evidence can make a difference. Stock taking. What was now a real achievement? What was a failure? Where we saw only different opinions, and what would we define as a missed opportunity? For Sanko, there is something like Sanko, success. Yeah? There were times where it even was discussed, do we need Sanko? Then the horizontal public health program, very important, was seen as a success. We discussed it. Being detached from social policy. In a lot of ministries are health and social security, and there are reasons for this. But of course, we have to have for each member state one commissioner, so you do the salami tactic and slice up all the things. And now I think Sanko will be divided too. The COEDs will get consumer safety. Then, missed opportunity, representation of health in other EU policies. This concept of health in all policies is great, adopted but not fulfilled totally. And about cooperation of Sanko with others, they are mixed. Let's have a look at an agency, ECDC. An agency strengthens the European dimension in health. If you have an agency, you are important. It's a very simple way. The more agency, the more important. I don't know if this is true, but at least you have an infrastructure for this. The coordinated infectious disease control is a really a step ahead. Missed opportunity scope of the mandate. There is always this discussion, why only infectious diseases, why not the others? Because we see that for chronic disease, they're in infectious disease origin, and that doesn't make sense to have two structures, and where to get the information, what we will see for our crisis now, how our health effects, can't ECDC do this. And the collaboration of the member states with ECDC is always a debate. The small member states love ECDC, the big member states often say, we don't need ECDC, we know better. Health in our policies has huge potential, but the deal of implementation was seen as a failure. And it's difficult to align Sanko interests with the other DGs. That's a natural thing. But by this, if you go through this later on, you can see how your strategy should be to make best use of this. And approach to lifestyle factors, work on tobacco grade, regulations on food safety, we take now for granted. Sometimes there is a scandal, but that we solve. But missed opportunities. Harmonized smoke-free legislation, prevention aspect of food neglected, alcohol policy, and weak policy instruments. That is something where we saw the most missed opportunity. But the opportunities are there. Make it happen. You run in Europe. Internal market. We saw that in tobacco, internal market rules could be used. But we see, on the other hand, that it was a failure in alcohol. And now, for example, the Scottish law, the Scottish court introduced minimum pricing for alcohol. Let's see what the European Court of Justice would say to this when they ask. And mobility of patients, at least we have a regulation on this. The impact on the quality of care, we don't know. It's a very tiny amount of money that is spent for cross-border care, 1%. Of the health budget is spent for this kind. And it will be difficult to empower the consumer that they can make use of. So the conclusion is, in a way, I will speed a little bit up, the glass is half full. From my personal
view, we have one failure that is not common. I'm part of the failure. I'm guilty too. We have progress on the indicators. Here the title from Eki to Heidi, Heidi the system. You all have been included in this indicator work. But from my personal view, we don't have a good health information system. And I spent 12 years working on it with a lot of you together, and I feel a little bit unhappy with the situation. There were several attempts to do this, and how can it happen that 500 million people endeavor can't have a decent health information system? And at the time of crisis, as I will show you, it's really difficult to argue. Until now, you saw the good sides and nice sailing, nice weather. But then the storm broke out, and we see now that Europe is, since several years, in economic crisis. Let's ignore this in the beginning a little bit. And now we begin to see the consequence. Part of this is too that we get the information so late. But before we blame everyone on everything, a history lesson. What was the deal? We start with an economic union. Then we go on to a monetary union. Then move on to a fiscal union. And then in the end, we would have a political union. That was the roadmap. And we expected to be several decades for this. The step from economic union to monetary union to the euro was speeded up by the fall of the Iron Curtain. Suddenly, there was this reunified Germany, a huge actor. And France, for example, said, we have to control them. Ms. Thatcher got her hand back and said, I don't want this. And how to get this done? So the agreement was, let's introduce the euro a little bit earlier than that. And by this, we can control Germany much better. Then, okay, when you have this, the monetary union, you have to do some issues to prepare for the fiscal union, banking control, all those things. It's not enough just to have a central bank. That was planned. But then suddenly, the euro went, well, quite without any problems. So those people who demanded, hey, we have to prepare the fiscal union, and you know, this control mechanism, we have to control banks a little bit more. Well, they said, come on, it's working. Why should we run a good running system? And that caused only trouble, and the people will not like it. And then, boof, the financial crisis struck in between. And there we are now, without these regulations, now we are demanding them. So they were in the plan, but again, here, external pressure caused trouble. So I don't know how long will this now take until the next steps are to a real fiscal union and how the Europeans will deal with it. We have these austerity measures. And the countries who are most suffering with it, and those references are not from economic textbooks, that's from the Lancet, things you can get at once in your library. It's all the quotes are down, read these articles, really enlightening reading. What you see here, those who start in 2008 with 100% and then suffer from their GDP are those countries who have the highest austerity. That's Portugal, Ireland, Greece, and Spain. And it's hard to get out of this depression. And those countries like the US, who invested a little bit more and had not such strict austerity measures, perform better. The logic behind this is that there might be limits to austerity. Austerity not always helps to get out of the financial crisis. And as at the theoretical moment that is accepted, even the European Monetary Fund now says, let's loosen a little bit of this austerity, because perhaps the regulations were too hard. While Germany is performing so well, it seems to be an isolated case that has to do with the history, because it had some reforms before the others. But in general, it seems to be that austerity does not work so much well in economic terms, and it seems that it really, in this hard case, has some health effects. This is a graphic where it shows suicide rates from the EU-12 and EU-15 regions, and it's a change in rate, and we saw always decreasing rate in suicide rates until 2007. Since then, it's going up. Suicide
depression before, anxiety before, and all those things are known from the literature. So when economic crises come up, that you worry about the future. Those who are always worried worry more, and there are effects that we see, but we see them only now. It sometimes it takes very long to get the information about this. And that is a big problem. For example, that is now what we know about Greece. Cuts in hospital budgets, -30%, admissions to public hospitals went up because higher demand, but admissions to private hospitals went down because of the surcharges that can't be. Suicide rate we saw going up there too. HIV infection increased by 50% because street workers program for needle exchange programs were stopped. And by this, you see now higher HIV rates. So in the way, the Greek government will pay double or three times for that what they saved by kicking out the street workers. NGOs had street clinics in Greece for the illegal immigrants because it was easy to get across the border, so you had to serve them. They didn't want to go to the official system. So around 3% in former times were treated, and now up to 30% of the ones contacted them. So there seems to be some changes in healthcare. Alcohol consumption went down, and by this drink driving went down, perhaps accidents went down. But we see those effects, but they are not from the European Health Information System. That was what the epidemiologist would say, Greystone epidemiology. Not Greystone in this case, but you really get out and try to get the things. WHO worked on this. There were two conferences in Oslo, Oslo 1 and Oslo 2, about the economic crisis. And there is now a summary with some suggestions what to do, how to help the members, how to help the states. And in the next regional committee in Turkey, they will be decided. So WHO is doing some work on this. And for example, that's a page from their report where how many countries cut their healthcare spending, and in which year? For example, in 2011, Andorra, Armenia, Czech Republic, Germany, Greece, Ireland, Netherlands, Portugal, Slovakia, Spain, and United Kingdom had cuts in their budget. So it's not only those countries that are really hit hard. A lot of other countries, and I really can say that have a look at this publication. It gives you in a nice summary way some basic facts that you can use to argue. The same was done for Ireland. There was a report, and I asked, why doesn't Ireland ask WHO for help? Normally, Turkmenistan and Azerbaijan ask for help. No, and you have good health economics here in Dublin, even Charles Norman. But then they said, yes, but it's different if our people say it or someone from abroad says it. So this report was to give some external view. Another tip, if no one listens to you, get external people. Okay, you give away your ideas, but if the effect is there, it's better than nothing happens. The summary of Ireland is this, ignore it now, we come. What is the Commission doing? There are now a new program, investing in health. How to work on the new on the health systems, how to deal with the human capital, and how to deal with healthcare. A lot of text. I just put you the solutions they have on there so that you can read it later. So that you can use this slide in your presentations. That is the way you will go. It's about increasing the efficiency of the system and getting new money in. But for example, for Ireland, the case is that they conclude, even if we do both, getting new money and there will be still some money there. I would like to see a parliamentarian to stand up to say, we get stock market information in real time, but we get health data, free health data. How shall I govern my system? How shall the health minister survive in a debate with the financial minister? When the financial minister said, I cut your budget by 20%, and the health minister can say, yeah, but you probably will increase the number of people not being treated by, I don't know exactly, but you will do so. Yeah, so what are the numbers? And you don't have numbers, because you can only tell, I will know 3 years later. That's not
Good. And it makes it really difficult for those people in there.
And it makes it difficult for you to argue for your issues. So, but in general, we don't need new data. We need existing data earlier. We need them perhaps like a sentinel or syndromic surveillance or a sample here and a sample there, but on the fly that we can argue. We don't need it all complete. And we have to find new ways to get this information. Come on, IT, the computer chip, every 2 years it doubled its intelligence. Just imagine that would happen to our head, what we could invent. In 10 years before, our ideas were more brighter than the chips. Now the chips are brighter than our ideas. They say we have the solution. What is the question? So let's find new ways. For example, with this birth register, 500,000 are enrolled. What great asset this is to really work on this. But we don't need it everywhere, but we have to prove the effects. And there are, for example, council conclusion towards modern, responsive, and sustainable health system. Member states have to produce their budget to the Commission. And healthcare reforms are part of this. So the Commission can demand some healthcare reforms. They even asked now a panel of wise people to help them in this. So they're really taking it serious to help to reform. On the other hand, you can argue, is this the new regulation via the vector? It's not covered by the treaty, perhaps. Is it violating the treaty? No one cares at the moment because it's about economic integration. And perhaps if someone would go to the European Court of Justice, they would say, you overdo your mandate. But we see this. And so what you saw at the last sentence of the mandate, and the health system is with the member state, I don't know if this will be true. It's what we see parallel to this, independent of Europe, is that those two systems, Bismarck and Beveridge, are not the clear cut. In 88, I was in London for a year to study the Beveridge system. That was great because it was really a different approach. But what did they do? They invented the purchase provider split. I said, that's from the health insurance idea. They regionalized. I said, no, it's a national health service. Why are you? No, we want to give the consumer more choice. I only hear this from health insurance based. Yeah, and then we offer our trusts and we delegated this, and you can go to the private sector. And we even have insurances now. So I said, hey, what is your system? The same is with the old Bismarck system. Much more taxpayers' money now. So we see some combination. Bismarck and Bellomark might be the new solution. We have a kind of unclear situation, but there are only a few possibilities to solve the common problems. So no wonder that in some areas, if you want to divide countries up, don't look for Bismarck and Beveridge anymore. You won't find differences. Look for other criteria. I told you about this strategy, 2008 to 2013. You don't have to read anything about it, but principle one. That is because there the Council adopted a statement on the common values and principles in EU healthcare systems. And the overarching values are universality, access to good quality care, equity, and solidarity. If you apply this, what is very much on each public health expert's heart, and we have the mandate for this, then we know the way how to do it. And it's agreed. We have this. And we made a whole conference on this. 600 people got together 2008 in the Gastein Valley and discussed the values in health in Europe. And at that time, I was the chief rapporteur. And the surprising result was, we know our values. We have no deficit of them. They are all clear there. What we have is a deficit of implementing them. But on the other hand, we have the knowledge, know the strategy, but we have to take action. And I think that's the main issue, that you are here to take action, to make this a better place in health, having in mind those values. They give you the right to argue. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. I think that has given us all a lot to think about. But I think the line on the deficit of implementation speaks pretty directly to to what both the vision and the two-plus projects are saying to the world. So, our next